packed up our books and our dishes, our dreams and your worsted wool suits. We sailed on the 8th of December. Farewell, old Hudson River, here comes the sea. And love was as new and as bright and as true when I loved you and you loved me. Two steamer trunks in the carriage, safe arrival, we cabled back home. It was just a few days before Christmas. We filled our stockings with wishes and walked for hours, arm in arm through the rain to the glassed in cafe that held us like hothouse flowers. Living in Paris, in attics and garrets, where the coal merchants climb every stair. The dance hall next door is filled with sailors and whores, and the music floats up through the air. Sandstone and oysters, cathedrals and cloisters, and time with its unerring aid. For now we can say we were lucky most days and throw a rose into the sand.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Pack Your Bags with the Hemingways webinar from the Hemingway Society. I'm Suzanne Del Gizzo. I'm editor of the Hemingway Review and chair of the media committee for the Hemingway Society. And so we welcome you today into a webinar, and I just want to remind you of a few basic ground rules. We have our presenters, and you can see and hear us, but we cannot see or hear you. You can communicate with us, ask us questions through the Q&A, which you'll find at the bottom of your Zoom screen. There'll be a series of controls or little icons, and one should be two bubbles, dialogue bubbles, and that's where you can ask our panelists questions, and we'll take questions at the end of the webinar. Before we get started, I also like to remind you that if you are a Hemingway Society member, we are having a member meeting immediately following the meeting today. So it starts at 2:30, and it's a separate Zoom link. It's a meeting link. And if you are not a member, I'm going to try. Yep, that worked. I'm going to put up in the chat the link to become a member in case you really want to join the meeting at 2:30. So at that meeting, we'll go over usual business, annual summaries of what we've been up to. But the most exciting bit will be that we will announce where our 2024 conference will be. I also would like to preview another event coming up in December. We are so pleased to host our second annual Holidays with Hemingway Zoom party. And we have quite an exciting event for you planned, everything from a DJ and bell ringing to bingo and a Hemingway haiku contest. So stay tuned for details. If you're a member, you'll get an email from us explaining all of the events and inviting you to sign up for that in the next couple of weeks. Okay, but today, as you know, we are entering into a period of celebration and commemoration in Hemingway studies. We're approaching the 100th anniversary of major events in his life and his work. Today, we turn to the fateful decision on the part of the newly married Ernest and Hadley to move to Paris. the media committee wanted to try to take us back in time to consider what the big transatlantic move must have been like. And that move was made 100 years ago in December. So without any further ado, I'm pleased to introduce Hemingway Society President Carl Eby, who will introduce the panel today. Thanks.
Great. Thanks so much, Suzanne. And many thanks to our panelists today and everyone on the media committee who helped plan today's event. So today we're going to travel back in time to explore Ernest and Hadley's move to Paris, which happened 100 years ago in December. And to help us on our journey, we're pleased to welcome Sandra Spanier, Edwin Earl Sparks Professor of English at Penn State University. Sandy is the general editor of the landmark Hemingway Letters Project, a comprehensive scholarly edition of the author's some 6,000 letters, approximately 85% of them never before published. The edition's being published by Cambridge University Press in a projected 17 volumes. Sandy and her team are currently working on volume 6, and Sandy will discuss Hemingway's travel plans and the conditions of his travel. J. Gerald Kennedy is Boyd Professor of English at LSU, author of Imagining Paris, and editor of the forthcoming Norton critical edition of In Our Time. I'm looking forward to seeing that. He's also the author of the Cambridge companion essay, Hemingway, Hadley, and Paris, The Persistence of Desire, and co-editor with Michael Von Cannon and Valerie Hemingway as advisory editor of the final volume of Hemingway's letters. Jerry will paint a picture of Paris as Hadley and Ernest would have encountered it in 1922. Gioia Diliberto is author of 7 books, most of which are set in Paris, including Paris Without End, The True Story of Hemingway's Wife, and a new book being released on December 7th, Coco at the Ritz, a novel inspired by the arrest and interrogation of Coco Chanel at the end of World War II. Gioia will help us to tap into Hadley's feelings and reactions to the move. Hilary Justice is Hemingway scholar in residence at the Ernest Hemingway Collection at the John F. Kennedy Presidential Library and Museum in Boston, for which she curated the permanent exhibit, Hemingway, A Life Inspired. Dr. Justice is author of several scholarly works, including her book, The Bones of the Others. She has served on the boards of the Hemingway Society and the Hemingway Foundation of Oak Park, and she is currently a member of the Hemingway Review's editorial board. Hilary will share relevant artifacts from this period in Hemingway's life from the Hemingway Collection. So, Sandy, over to you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm glad to be here and in wonderful company. And Gioia, I have not met you before, but we've certainly used your work and admired it. I'm going to share my screen here. Okay, are you seeing the young Ernest there? Okay. This period takes us back to the very first volume of letters that we published, which spanned the time that Hemingway did go to Paris with Hadley. And we will, sorry about this, there. As you know, Ernest and Hadley are married in September of 1921 in Horton Bay, Michigan. He had come back from the war wanting a long time to go back to Italy and talked with Hadley about going to Italy. But living in Chicago, he met Sherwood Anderson, who had told him that Paris was the place for a young writer to be. So the travel plans changed a bit. And on November 23rd, 1921, Ernest and Hadley filled out their passport application in Chicago. Interestingly, it was witnessed by Kate Smith, Catherine Smith, journalist living at the Chicago Beach Hotel. This is the passport that was issued to both of them. Ernest's picture is on the front of it. Hadley is on the back here, and she's crossed out because later on, when he got a separate passport and she was issued her own. There's not a lot written. He did not write a whole lot of letters about the journey, but he did write a letter just before leaving the hotel in New York City. Dear Dad and Mother and Children, we're writing this from the hotel just before we leave. Everything is very lovely, fine trip, and enjoyed the dates and apples, Mother's check and Nunbones and Mazween's letters tremendously. They boarded the Leopoldina, which was a French line ship that had originally been built around 1901, 1902. It's a German ship, the Hamburg American Line. It was confiscated during World War I, and after the war, made its way into the French line of ships. It was decommissioned in 1929. So it was already a pretty old, it was not one of the glamorous ships. One of the things that we enjoy doing at the Hemingway Letters Project is digging around in old papers and documents. And it's fun to look at the historical newspapers to see the kinds of news about transportation, travel, and mail. So the New York Times had a daily shipping and mails column. And here we see the Leopoldina with the destination of Havre, Le Havre, France, not carrying mail this trip, sailing at 3 p.m. on December 8th. Their first stop after the transatlantic journey is Vigo, Spain. And again, we can track this. The New York Times had them landing in Vigo on December 18th. And now we have a letter that was written to the Hemingway family. We've had a fine trip, stopped at Vigo in Spain, went ashore in a motor launch, only very rough one day, then a regular hurricane. Good weather, balance of the time. In the harbor were great schools of tuna. Some jumped 6 and 8 feet out of water chasing sardines. And this is where they would have disembarked in Vigo to this passenger terminal for their brief stay. This is a vintage view of what the town looked like. And this is Vigo Bay, and what's interesting is to see how Hemingway describes the same situation to different people. So this is to his friend Bill Smith, Kate Smith's brother. Vigo, Spain, that's the place for a mail, a harbor almost landlocked about as big as Little Traverse Bay in Michigan, with big brown mountains. The bay swarms with tuna. That was underlined three times in the letter. I didn't know how to do it on the screen. They behave exactly like Lanesteins, and that's the private lingo for rainbow trout, which has a whole etymology, probably from Stein, his name Stein, Rainsteins. Sardines for shiners, chase them the same way, and I saw three in the air at once, one easily 8 feet, the biggest one they've taken this year weighed 850 pounds, exclamation point. When he tells this about this journey to Sherwood and Tennessee Anderson after arriving in Paris, it's a little more landscape oriented. We came via Spain, missed all but a day of the big storm. You ought to see the Spanish coast, big brown mountains looking like tired dinosaurs slumped down into the sea, lighthouse looking like a little candle stuck up on the dinosaur's shoulder. And then a month or two later, he is writing for the Toronto Star Weekly. And again, he digs back into his experience and writes about Vigo, Spain, a pasteboard looking village, cobble streeted, white and orange plastered, set up on one side of a big, almost landlocked harbor that is large enough to hold the entire British Navy. And he recycles the brown mountains slump down to the sea like tired old dinosaurs, which he had tried out in that letter to Sherwood Anderson. And the color of the water is as blue as a chromo of the bay at Naples. Another thing that happened, this is the same letter to his parents now. An episode on the ship, she's playing the piano, and he talks about to his parents having a boxing exhibition one night. They took out three tables in the dining room, made a ring. I boxed three rounds with Henry Cuddy, a middleweight from Salt Lake City who's going over to fight in Paris. We trained together on board, and in the third round, I had him on the verge of a knockout. Got the decision. Cuddy wants me to fight in Paris. Hash was in my corner and wiped me off with a towel between rounds. So that's to his family on December 20th. This is to Bill Smith. And again, we have Hash wielding the towel in my corner for a three-round session with young Cuddy, Salt Lake City, 158 pounder. He's going to Paris to fight, has three fights there, one in Milan. We train daily throughout the voyage. I love the last line. You'll have to get Hash to tell you about the bout. If I wrote it, you'd think it was fiction. Wemage. This is 20th of December. This is Salt Lake City, 19 December, 1921. Kid Cuddy is not in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean boxing with Ernest Hemingway. Kid Cuddy is in a series of boxing bouts in Salt Lake City. On the 19th, he lost by decision in a six-round headliner. So this is one of the interesting things now that we have the opportunity for looking at historical newspapers and other primary sources that have been digitized, we can start to dig a little deeper. I'm not sure if Hemingway was making this up or if he was duped by a boxer on board who said he was Kid Cuddy. That is hard to tell. They made their way, the ship landed at Le Havre in the English Channel, closer to Paris. And we have this time in the New York Herald Paris edition, the daily report of the passengers aboard the ships that are landing. The stamp there from their joint passport shows the day that they arrived. And the New York Herald reported Mr. and Mrs. E.M. Hemingway among the passengers that arrived on the Leopoldina. This is the letter that Hemingway was writing to his family to describe the boxing match, Vigo. He said he would mail it as soon as they got to Le Havre, which they did on December 20th. I find it interesting that the postmark lets us know that it didn't actually get stamped and sent until December 25th. And I love this little note on the back in his father's hand, read and returned promptly to Daddy enclosed. Now he's writing to Sherwood Anderson again about making their way from Le Havre by train to Paris. And again, just the vividness of the description, coming up on the train through Normandy with villages with smoking manure piles and long fields and woods with the leaves on the ground and the trees trimmed bare of branches way up their trunks and a roll of country and towers up over the edge, dark stations and tunnels, and third-class compartments full of boy soldiers. And finally, everyone asleep in your own compartment, leaning against each other and joggling with the sway of the train. There's a deathly tired silence you can't get anywhere except a railway compartment at the end of a long ride. And there they are in Paris, arrived. One of the first things he did on December 28th was go introduce himself to Sylvia Beach. And this is a photograph that she took. That's her handwriting there. This is from the Princeton Library's collection of Sylvia Beach materials. So he did not take very long to make use of those letters of introduction, at least not to Sylvia Beach. They took an apartment in this neighborhood around the Place de la Contrescarpe, not a fashionable area, as he talks about in A Movable Feast. There's a plaque on the door, and I know Jerry's been there, and others of us have also made the pilgrimage. Across the Luxembourg Garden is one of the other famed literary figures to whom he has a letter of introduction, Gertrude Stein, who lives there and holds the salon. Here she is with Alice B. Toklas. And this is a letter I love because, like many of the letters that he writes in that first fresh encounter with Paris, with Europe, you just get that youthful exuberance about this whole experience. We know a good batch of people now in Paris, and if we allowed, it would have all our time taken up socially, but I'm working very hard and we keep plenty of time to ourselves. It is fun living in this oldest quarter of Paris, and we have a wonderful time. Paris is so very beautiful that it satisfies something in you that is always hungry in America. Now, this letter goes on. It's a three-page letter, and this is amazing. Gertrude Stein, who wrote Three Lives and a number of other good things, was here to dinner last night and stayed till midnight. She's about 55, I guess, and very large and nice. She's very keen about my poetry. My Corona typewriter is being repaired. The femme de ménage knocked off my writing table while she was cleaning, and I don't get it until tomorrow. And so it's this mixture in the letters of the sublime and the mundane. Meeting Gertrude Stein for the first time with a sort of gee whiz, breathless narrative about that. And then we can see that next day he got his typewriter back. And so he continues the letter on his typewriter and continues to report that on Friday they're going to tea at Ezra Pound's, and he apologizes for his letters. Sorry to write such dull letters, but I get such full expression in my articles and the other work I'm doing. I'm quite pumped out and exhausted from a writing standpoint. And so my letters are very commonplace. If I wrote nothing but letters, all of that would go into them. They were only in Paris for a few days before deciding to go to Switzerland. And let me go back, and the one point I wanted to make here in particular is that a letter like this is very important because of how it can correct the biographical record and biographical interpretations. Carlos Baker, in his biography, had written that after Ernest and Hadley came to Paris, Ernest was shy and slow about seeking out the famous Americans to whom Anderson had written on his behalf. And he goes on to say it was March before he summoned up courage to call on Gertrude Stein. And then he has them walking to the Luxembourg Garden, across Luxembourg Gardens to Stein's salon. And Michael Reynolds puts the date of first meeting of Hemingway and Stein as March 8th of 1922, because this letter had been unavailable. This was a letter that had belonged to Ernie Mainland, Ernest Hemingway Mainland, and his family, and it came to the Penn State University libraries in the course of a letters project. But this is a way in which the letters can fill in what we couldn't have known before. And again, correct things. Michael Reynolds, believing that they had met on March 8th, writes in the Paris years, on March 9th, the day after his first visit to Stein's apartment, Hemingway wrote Sherwood Anderson, "Gertrude Stein and me are just like brothers, and we see a lot of her. One meeting does not make a brotherhood, but knowing how enthusiastic Anderson was about Gertrude, Ernest exaggerated without a blush." Well, he may have been exuberant, but he was not, it wasn't just one day that they had known each other at this point. So they decided to go to Switzerland for a few weeks before actually moving into the apartment. And Hemingway was enchanted by bobsledding and winter sports. This is a photograph of, he's on the end of this. And of course, he wrote pieces about this for the Toronto Star Weekly. I was very excited on a trip to Switzerland to find the house where Ernest and Hadley stayed, which is between Chambly and a little village of Les Avants up the road. And again, I want to just end with what I think is a wonderful letter that, again, captures the value of letters in that it's just the fresh experience in all of its, just the white hot experience of encountering European society here. Yes, okay. Dear old Butstein, wish to hell you were here. You must have all this before you die. There's no living in the States. Poison the Unc and come over here. Poison the Madame and come over with Smith. He goes on, what's the use of trying to live in such a goddamn place as America when there is Paris and Switzerland and Italy? My God, the fun a man has. When people lie to you and say America is as beautiful or as much fun to live in, give them the razz. It is so beautiful here that it hurts in a numb sort of way all the time. Only when you're with somebody your lover's with, the beauty gets to be just sort of a tremendous happiness. It's so damn beautiful, Butstein, and we have so damn much fun. So that is a capsule through the letters, at least, of Hemingway's travels and first impressions of Paris.
So, Suzanne, should I take off here?
Yes, please. Over to you, Jerry. Thanks.
Thank you, Sandy. That that last letter was so good and so perfect for what I want to emphasize. I have a PowerPoint that I will try to get through here. Can you see that? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Good. So. The Hemingways arrived in Paris. Now, why is my screen not? There it goes. All right. I want to begin with this well-known quote from A Movable Feast that resonates with some of the things that Sandy said, and it'll be familiar to everyone, but I want to underscore the emphasis here on the problem of right and wrong, the ethical ambiguity that Hemingway recognizes as a complication. Paris was a very old city and we were young and nothing was simple there, not even poverty, nor sudden money, nor the moonlight, nor right and wrong, nor the breathing of someone who lay beside you in the moonlight. And of course, that someone changed for Hadley or for Ernest. I mean, and that is part of the fascination of that quotation. Talk a little bit about the city of Paris. Obviously, the end of World War I is the immediate and most important context for their arrival. Paris was still very much just beginning to recover from the war. There was indeed a lost generation, as Gertrude Stein remarked, but it was the French. 1.5 million people, soldiers were killed in the war, and this produced a population decline in Paris, as a matter of fact, as well as a labor shortage. There was also a low birth rate in Paris at this time. The potential daddies were not coming back. Paris was also beset with economic woes. There was tremendous price inflation. The franc was one of the most deflated currencies in Europe. And there was also a great housing shortage in Paris. There was, in fact, among the French, a great deal of hunger. So when we think about the Jazz Age and the crazy years in Paris, we tend to forget that there was a great deal of suffering that lower and lower middle class French were experiencing at the same time that American expatriates were having fun. It was a city of strangers. It was flooded, even though there were many Frenchmen who never came back from the war. The city was jammed with international expatriates. Many came from Poland, Russia, Italy, and Portugal. There were also a lot of expatriates or immigrants in town from the African colonies, many of whom had fought for the French in World War I. If you know Hemingway's prose poems, Paris 1922, you remember the one that is set at the Jardin des Plantes with the Senegalese soldiers. That is a very apt piece that captures a sense of the exotic influx of immigrants into Paris at the same time that it was being inundated, absolutely inundated, by Americans. 100,000 in 1921. American businesses were setting up in France. This picture of the Place de l'Opéra is really sort of the focal point for American business interests. The American Express office is roughly located from the vantage point of this picture. So it's looking at the Garnier Opera House, obviously. Café de la Paix, the Café de la Paix setting in My Old Man is on the corner there on the left. The American invasion also included the creation of American bars all over Paris, and especially in Montparnasse, the Dome, the Select when it opened in 1924, the Dingo Bar, where Hemingway met Fitzgerald. There were dozens and dozens of American bars in Paris. And this was the source of, in fact, considerable French resentment. They saw Americans spending money like it meant nothing, walking around as if they owned the town. And actually, Fitzgerald captures this in Babylon Revisited very nicely. And also, this slide captures the transportation in Paris. And here you have taxi cabs, buses, the horse-drawn carts, the fiacre, and the most popular mode of ground transportation in Paris at this time was the streetcar line, the tramways. Also there in the bottom right, you see the entrance to the Paris Metro stop. The Paris Metro network had been completed in 1920. Now I'm moving on to the quarter in which Hemingway lived. He was, Sandy showed a picture of this building before, and the blue door, in fact, marks the door that Hemingway went into. His apartment was au troisième, that's fourth floor, American, but you can see the window that is completely open. That one and the one to the left were for Hemingway's apartment, which looked down the street that you see on the far right side of the picture. That is essentially the view from Hemingway's apartment. I included a picture of this in Imagining Paris, and I'm embarrassed to say I mislabeled it as the Rue du Cardinal Lemoine. So sometimes you just have to keep working and keep learning. The famous Bal au Printemps, the Bal Musette that Hemingway said they lived above and could hear the accordion playing, is this blue shop in the lower left. This immediate neighborhood was, of course, the site of another dance hall, the Bal de la Montagne Sainte-Geneviève. The Bal au Printemps, the one that we see in this picture, was an ordinary working class dance hall, the one that Braddock talks about at the beginning of The Sun Also Rises. But the one at the Bal de la Montagne Sainte-Geneviève was the one where Jake meets Brett. And it was about 5 minutes away. Other notable sites, Sandy mentioned the Place Contrescarpe, The Rue Mouffetard runs up into that, the wonderful crowded Market Street, and in a building that is actually just behind Hemingway's apartment here is the hotel where Verlaine died, where Hemingway says he had a writing room, although when he ever used it, who knows. February and March of 1922 were probably marked the longest period he was in Paris and could be using such a writing room. The Rue Rollin on the right side looks down to the Arène de Lutèce, the Roman arena that was built in the first century. And I think this is part of Hemingway's sense of Paris as a very old city. He was surrounded by things that reminded him of both the antiquity of Paris and the relative lack of the past in the United States. Nearby also was the Pantheon, the building where the French buried their famous dead. And I think that inspired Hemingway as he discovered that the French, unlike the Americans, the French honored and revered great writers. They buried them in stately buildings. And when they died, they put up plaques on their apartment, such as the one we put up in 1994 at the Hemingway Fitzgerald Conference. This is just a brief map of the neighborhood, and I'm not going to spend too much time here, but the star marks the site of Hemingway's apartment. You can see the Pantheon just to the northwest. And the dance hall of Bal de la Montagne Saint-Geneviève is right at the top of the picture. That arrow marks the site of that. The Arène de Lutèce, you can see to the east of the Hemingway's apartment, and the Rue Mouffetard runs up into the Place Contrescarpe. This is where the hotel was where Verlaine died. And I have a series of slides here just to describe what I think is the most important impact of Paris on the couple. It was the period we call the Année Folle, where there was great experimentation, not only in art, literature, and music, but also in personal lives, in lifestyles, as we like to say today. It was a place for breaking rules and escaping the past. It was also a place where the cafe represented an entirely new experience for American expatriates in the sense that this was a cultural site that was built around nonstop enjoyment, drinking, which of course was very different from the prohibition in the United States. It was a scene of sociability and also of the beginning of sexual liaisons. Another aspect of the Paris effect is the fact that there was indeed a kind of attitude created by the presence of so many artists and writers and musicians. It popularized a bohemian lifestyle in which people had relationships with multiple muses or models. And it was also a place that was distinctly not puritanical. Sex, sexual openness, nudity were quite commonplace in Paris. And this too had its impact. It was a place where homosexuality was openly tolerated, bisexuality. I put a picture of Hemingway and Robert McAlmon in the right-hand corner, not to imply that that's a gay couple, but simply that Hemingway in his personal life became implicated, drawn into relationships with many people who belonged to the homosexual community. There were, and Gertrude Stein was another, and Hemingway was intrigued, I think, although he was derisive in some places, I think he was absolutely intrigued by the homosexual culture or counterculture in Paris. this stimulated a sense of personal freedom. You could look any way you wanted to look, wear your hair as long as you wanted, dress with impunity, and in effect, create a Parisian identity, which I think is what we see in that other picture from Sylvia Beach's bookstore on the left there, Ernest looking a bit bohemian as he as he actually is beginning his career. Over the years of their stay in Paris, both went through a metamorphosis. I think Hadley clearly shed a lot of the timidity that came from her very oppressive upbringing by a domineering mother and a kind of bullying sister. In Paris, she became her own woman. She became adventurous, liked sexual games. She could really drink. And she ultimately accepted a triangular relationship. I'm not implying that that was something she welcomed, but she recognized it or accepted it as something Ernest wanted at that time. Hemingway broke loose from Oak Park and its taboos. He experimented in androgyny. He sought muses and he liked risk-taking. Who was Hemingway's first muse in Paris? Well, you could say maybe it was Duff Twisden. I don't know. So I want to close, and I apologize for running over here. Want to close with Hadley's imprint on In Our Time. Her presence is powerful in Our Time, especially Cat in the Rain and Out of Season, where there's just the hint of a pregnancy that no one wants to talk about. She's also an absent presence in Cross Country Snow, where Helen is pregnant, and in On Writing, where Nick evokes the friction that develops between them when she was not well. The background, in effect, the subtext of Big Two-Hearted River. Hadley was with Ernest when he was writing The Sun Also Rises, but she disappeared from the story. She was literally excised from the manuscript, and one could, I suppose, read it as the sign of an impending break. But after many years, Hemingway returned to Hadley, at least in his imagination, memory, and affection, writing nostalgically, idealistically about her in A Movable Feast. I wished I had died before I ever loved anyone but her. Thank you. That's it.
Thank you, Jerry. Wonderful. And that, what an amazing cover. At this point, I'm just going to say to Gioia and Hilary, we are running just a little bit late. So if you could be sensitive to that. No, it's okay. It's everything. And it's a sign of a great conversation. To our viewership, if we run a little over, just know that we will start the meeting as soon as we hang up from this one, the membership meeting. But we will try to get some time for Q&A. Gioia, thank you.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Okay. Yes.
I'm going to make one attempt to share the screen. And if it fails, so be it. So let's see if you can see these pictures. Can you see these pictures? Yeah, it worked. Great. So I am so moved by the Hadley Ernest Hemingway story, 35 years after I wrote my book. I was tearing up at the song at the opening of the Mary Chapin song. And I remember so vividly the couple of the letters that Sandy read from and the passage that Jerry noted from A Movable Feast. I can remember it like it was yesterday, even though it was so long ago. I first became obsessed with Hadley on the plane to Paris for my own honeymoon 41 years ago. I read A Movable Feast on that journey for the very first time, and I was just so moved by the story. This shy, sheltered, in those days they would have called her a spinster, who falls in love with this handsome, brilliant writer who whisks her off to Paris, where they embark on this exciting, adventurous life while the young man is carving the prose style that's going to change American writing. And it's so achingly romantic, particularly because, as we all know, it ended so sadly. At the time, I was a young wife like Hadley, and I was very hopeful, like Hadley was, about the future. But I think I had a much more comfortable first trip to Paris than Hadley did. And one reason was because I was not suffering with a horrible haircut. She got a bob in New York before they set sail. And at the time, 1921, that was a radical act. There were nurses and teachers in some places in America who actually got fired for bobbing their hair. She probably did it at Hemingway's urging. Her hair was her crowning glory. She had the most gorgeous copper-colored hair that was waist-length and luminous, which she wore, like most women did at that time, coiled on the top of her head with a lot of hairpins. And the pineapple bob that she got was so called because it made the hair look like a pineapple, and it was just really hideous. And she felt terrible and unconfident about her looks, more so than usual. And so it was not a great way to start off her trip to Paris. Hemingway captured her unhappiness about her hair, which came to symbolize a deeper discontent about her life, in the story Cat in the Rain, which Jerry made reference to. She went over and sat in front of the mirror of the dressing table, looking at herself with a hand glass. She studied her profile, first one side, then the other. Then she studied the back of her head and neck. "Don't you think it would be a good idea if I let my hair grow out?" she asked. "I get so tired of it. I get so tired of looking like a boy." She laid the mirror down on the dresser and went over to the window and looked out. It was getting dark. "I want to pull my hair back tight and smooth and make a big knot at the back that I can feel," she said. Despite the haircut, though, the move to Paris was an exciting adventure for Hadley. And the journey had been long and arduous. And when they arrived, they were very tired. And she was homesick. And it didn't help that they were staying at the Hotel Jacob on the Rue Jacob, that was just filled with Americans. And so all she saw were Americans and heard English and American accents, and it made her miss home and her friends even more. They had room number 14, which they got for 12 francs a night, and it had a sink with hot and cold running water, but the bathroom was down the hall. And the hotel, as we all know, was in the heart of Left Bank Bohemia. James Joyce lived nearby. Oscar Wilde had died in a hotel 25 years earlier, I think, around the corner. Natalie Barney, the beautiful American heiress and sapphic poet, had a salon across the street. I don't know if you can see. There's some more here, the wedding pictures. But then when she walked outside and walked around Paris, she started to feel much better. I mean, how can you possibly remain sad walking around beautiful Paris? And they would stop at a cafe and get warm by the charcoal heaters, and they would have pastries, and they would drink, and they would drink, and they would drink. As Jerry pointed out, they just drank so much, and they would throw up together. And it was prohibition at home, but in Europe, alcohol was glorified as something glamorous and liberating, and Hemingway thought that it fueled his talent, but of course it did nothing of the sort. It was incredibly ugly and destructive. And Hadley, in fact, had a drinking problem her entire life. I don't know if you would call her an alcoholic, but she never was able to give up drinking, though she did. She lived to a pretty old age. Jerry and Sandy talked about the apartment that they moved into at 74 Rue du Cardinal-Lemoine in the rough working class neighborhood. And I just wanted to point out that they could have afforded a nicer place because they had Hadley's inheritance, and they had money that Hemingway was earning from journalism, and apartments were cheap, though they were hard to come by, and they could have lived in a more comfortable way, but domestic comfort was not important at all to Hemingway. He wanted to spend the money on travel and experience, and Hadley went along with that. They did manage to pay a cook who cooked most of their meals when they weren't going to restaurants, but she was going along with his interest in spending what money they had on travel and experience. She later complained that she walked around that winter with holes in her shoes and had the sniffles all winter long as a result, because he wouldn't let her buy new shoes. And, you know, when you read things like that or hear her, as I did on the Alice Sokolov tapes talking about this, it's easy to get very angry at Hemingway and to feel that he had mistreated her, and also annoyed at Hadley for her passivity and for, you know, being such a disappointment from a feminist point of view for not sticking up for herself more. But I think, that's how I felt 35 years ago when I was first researching her, but I don't feel that way now so much. I feel more that I have to look at it from her point of view, and she was deeply in love and he was opening up her life to the world. As Jerry pointed out, she's considered this marriage, this love, this adventure in Paris to be a great explosion into life. She described it, Hemingway, as giving her the key to the world. And I think that that's what the important thing is here. She knew that Hemingway was married to his work, first of all, before her, and that she was condemned to spend long hours alone wandering around Paris. And again, at first it was very difficult for her because she only had her schoolgirl French, though her French improved, and she felt conspicuous with this terrible pineapple bob haircut and with her unchic American clothes. But eventually she made friends and felt more at home, even though she knew that most of the people that they were meeting were interested in Hemingway, as she called him, the big bug in the family, and not in her. But then she had her music, which he supported. He was very proud of her talent, and she managed to find a upright piano to rent and moved it into the little flat. It was an upright, so it wasn't that big, but the flat was so small they had to move the dining table into the bedroom to accommodate it, and they would have dinner parties in the bedroom and entertain people like Gertrude Stein and Alice B. Toklas in the eating on the dining table in the bedroom. I think that ultimately the experience of moving to Paris with Hemingway was what enabled Hadley to come into her own true identity. And Jerry made reference to this tortured past that she'd had. She had endured an awful lot as a young woman, not only this awful, overbearing mother, and Hemingway always said that it was a contest between his mother and Hadley's mother in an all-time bitch show to find out, to see who was the worst mother. But the death of her eldest sister, Dorothea, and her terrible sister, Jerry also made reference to him, her father who killed himself. And had she stayed in St. Louis, who knows what would have happened? She maybe just would have ended up a recluse because she had had her own bouts with depression and suicidal thoughts. But she grew strong and healthy from this marriage and from this experience of moving to Paris. And that is an irony, a very sad irony, that it was, let's see if I have any more pictures here, that I don't think that's the pineapple bob. I think it had grown out by then. And that's my favorite picture of them in Shambi and fishing on the side there, that it was his giving her this great sense of identity that enabled her to withstand his betrayal of her 6 years later. So I will turn it over now to Hilary. And I will unshare my screen.
Thanks, Gioia. I will now attempt to share my screen. Do we have slides? Thanks, Suzanne. So today I'll be sharing some of the highlights from Hemingway's very, very early years in Paris, from the Ernest Hemingway Collection at the John F. Kennedy Library, starting with the Hemingway's postcard of Notre Dame. Some of our images are really hard to date. Hemingway was, of course, in Paris twice. So this might be from the 1920s, but it also could be from the 1940s. No way to know, but if you're gonna buy one postcard during your two trips to Paris, I think that's the right one to buy. So just to give you a little bit of an introduction, if you're not familiar with the Ernest Hemingway Collection, it was the gift to the Kennedy Library of Mary Hemingway. It's divided into three sections: textual, audiovisual, and then museum objects. Our textual collection contains over 90% of Hemingway's known papers. The audiovisual collection includes over 11,000 photographs. And these are Hemingway's own photographs. These are not photographs that people have given to us because they happen to have Hemingway in them. So his photograph collection was quite extensive. And then a small collection of museum objects. We're mostly in archives, not a museum. But we do have approximately 100 museum objects, and that includes anything that is three-dimensional. So our textual holdings include manuscripts, typescripts, correspondence, maps, official documents, books, and paper ephemera, for example, bullfight tickets. I looked through our books holdings. We don't have a lot of Hemingway's books. Most of those obviously remained in Cuba, but we do have two very interesting ones that are copyrighted 1922. The first one is a press copy, an unbound press copy of James Joyce's Ulysses, published, of course, by Sylvia Beach at Shakespeare and Company. It is unbound, and Hemingway wrote his name in orange. It's got his signature across the cover page vertically. I have seen it twice. It lives in the vault. Obviously, this is a priceless, priceless artifact. But I can report that after the first section of pages, the rest of the pages of the book remain uncut. So Hemingway did not get very far when reading Ulysses. And the second book from 1922 is about Goya. And so art is going to be a little bit of a theme today. So I just wanted to highlight that. Here is that wonderful passport issued 1921. Sandy shared that a bit earlier. I did some zooming in on our digital copy. And the countries to visit include the British Isles, France, Italy, Germany, Austria, Czechoslovakia, and, quote, necessary countries en route. It also mentions that the bearer is accompanied by his wife, Hadley, and Ernest Hemingway is described thus: age 22, height 6'1", face wide, mouth regular, chin pointed. And what I found most interesting was that he had to list an object of his visit, and it wasn't become an expatriate community member. It wasn't, you know, recraft my literary style so that someday I will win a Nobel Prize. It's listed as travel and study. And I think that's very interesting because there's a performative element to Hemingway always, no matter when you're looking at him. And I think here he was trying to impress whoever was in the passport office who was asking him the questions. I'm going to travel, but I'm also going to study. I am not just a dilettante. So I want to pick up on that study detail a little bit more as we go on. In our photographs collection, these are a little bit harder to date. So there aren't that many photographs that I can get specifically from Hemingway's first years in Paris, much less to 1922. But this is one of them. This is a view from the window in the building that Jerry showed you photographs of, and written on the back of this, it's sort of, I don't know whose handwriting it is, and maybe Sandy will recognize it. I don't. It reads, taken from the kitchen at window of number 74, Casa Lalouen, when Hadley and Ernest were living there. I don't know if that's Hadley's handwriting or Grace Hemingway's handwriting, maybe Marceline. I don't think it's Pauline Hemingway, but again, I am not sure. But they didn't live in this apartment for very long. So this is probably summertime based on the clothing of the people in the picture. So the summer of 1922. The other two pictures that I can firmly identify as belonging to 1922 are these two pictures of Hadley Hemingway. And Gioia, you showed the one on the left. I think that's my favorite picture of Hadley. The light is so beautiful. The furnishings are so sparse, but so thoughtful. And she just looks utterly calm and happy just reading a book probably from Shakespeare and Company from the lending library at Sylvia Beach's. We can date this to 1922 in part because she's dressed for summertime and she's not heavily pregnant, which she would have been the next year. My second favorite picture of Hadley is the other one. It's she's lying on her back on a porch swing slash bed in an abandoned cabin in the Black Forest where she and Ernest and some friends went hiking later in the summer of 1922. And it's interesting, as soon as they get to Paris, if they're alone, every picture of Hadley seems to be lying down. And I think this really speaks to their joy in each other's sexual company and how utterly relaxed and happy they were with each other in that first year. Very, very sexy, that one of her with her feet up on the side of the porch swing there. Moving on to the museum objects that we hold, there aren't very many. And some of the reasons for this is that most of Hemingway's personal belongings either remained in Cuba or were moved by him and Mary to their home in Idaho. But our three-dimensional holdings include art, taxidermy, furniture. We have a couple of camp stools from the second African safari, some personal items. But basically art is where it is. So these four oil paintings are the ones we own the originals of. Everything else we have is a reproduction and is in private collection or at the National Gallery. So we own these four oil paintings by André Masson. And these were painted between 1920 and 1922, which is the crucial time of Hemingway's arrival in Paris. And here I have to highlight that bit about going to study. What was he gonna study exactly? Well, I'm not sure what he was going to study. Well, I am pretty sure what he was going to study. I just haven't gotten to that yet. But one thing was for sure, his college library would be Sylvia Beach's bookstore. And his freshman seminar professor was Gertrude Stein. And she very famously said to him, you can either buy clothes or buy pictures. One of the reasons I suspect we don't have very many artifacts from Paris is because he did spend a lot of his money on pictures. One of the reasons I suspect we don't have a lot of photographs from these earliest years is that I don't think Ernest and Hadley owned a camera until after they had their first child. Most of the family snapshots that we have, Bumby is old enough to walk. And there's also an absence of photographs from their time in Toronto. But one thing we have that we have in spades are these lovely original oil paintings. And we know that Hemingway actually purchased more. We don't have them. So we have these four paintings by the French painter André Masson, and he's not terribly well known. He's certainly not Cézanne, who we know influenced Hemingway. We know he's not Picasso. Hemingway simply couldn't afford those. And so Hemingway followed Gertrude Stein's advice to buy the pictures created by people he knew, people his age, people who, like him, had served in World War I. And so I'll do some close-ups on these later, but I wanted to give you sort of the aggregate. André Masson was just a couple years older than Hemingway. He too moved to Paris for training at the advice of a mentor, Jerry mentioned Sherwood Anderson. He too was wounded in World War I. He had a chest wound at the Somme and he was invalided out of the service and it took him years to recover. And he actually suffered badly from shell shock and depression and suicidal thoughts as a result of that injury. He was friends with Juan Gris, who is slightly better known in the art world as having an association with Hemingway because Juan Gris' Bullfighter is the frontispiece to Death in the Afternoon. He was also friends with Ezra Pound. So it's possible that Hemingway met Masson through Pound. It's also possible he met him through Stein. André Masson's work attracted the notice of Gertrude Stein just after World War I. He is mentioned in her autobiography of Alice B. Toklas, although she also mentions that when he got into surrealism and automatic painting, something she was accused of was automatic writing, and she disdained that. He did something called automatic painting, which was scattering glue on canvas and then throwing sand on it. She had no respect for that. But his early work, she found very impressive. In the period that we're looking at, Masson was making a transition from a strongly cubist influence to a strongly surrealist influence. And the forest paintings we'll take a look at a little bit more closely in a second really show that transition. So Hemingway arrived in Paris not only as this tremendous post-World War I rupture from everything that came before, but there were subtle ruptures and debates of art and philosophy of art and how you could represent poetry in visual arts and how you could represent, you know, music and prose. And so this was a really dynamic, intense time artistically across all genres in Paris. And so Hemingway landed right in the thick of it. And we can see that in Masson's paintings, which we'll look at in a second. Like Hemingway, Masson fell in love with the landscapes of Spain. They were a huge influence in his later life. He's mentioned in Green Hills of Africa and Islands in the Stream. And also I found this picture, and although it's from a later period, I had to include it. He loved cats. And so there's my requisite cat picture. The photograph on the left actually has Masson. He's the bottom figure in the photograph, and the top one is Juan Gris. So they had their cohort. Our catalog entry for The Throw of the Dice dates the painting to 1920, and I wanted to highlight a couple of things that strike me as similar to how Hemingway worked. The Throw of the Dice is filled with references to events and personal experiences, as well as his acquaintances. And so this is a painting Masson did in 1920. The, you know, effect, I'll get a closer view for you. It's got a strong cubist element, and it's something like a collage effect that we'll see more strongly in Juan Gris's work, which is associated with Hemingway a little bit later. But this is sort of how Hemingway worked, to take just details like the dice cup and the pipe and the young woman's eyes, and to suggest a layered set of figures based on acquaintances built around it as sort of a framing device. The forest paintings were bought as a triptych. Colette Hemingway notes that they were purchased, definitely purchased during the Hemingway's first years in Paris, and probably in 1922. But when they were painted, they show the evolution of Masson's style in a way that really interestingly sort of mirrors Hemingway. If you look at how his prose style developed from the Paris 1922 prose poems that Jerry mentioned into the Inner Time chapters, into the longer works of Inner Time, and then of course throughout his life. Not in exactly the same way, but in any case. So this is the earliest of the three. This one is dated certainly to 1920. It is by far the closest to realism, and I think it would make a wonderful cover for In Our Time. It sort of evokes Michigan to me, but that could be fanciful. In any case, you can see trees are identifiably trees. Ground growth is identifiably ground growth, and clouds are identifiably clouds. This one, which is dated certainly to 1922, is sort of a midway point between realism and Masson is moving into surrealism. He was very interested in psychology, having been an inpatient in psychiatric institutions and having to wrestle with his own demons after his wounding on the Somme. And you can see that things are getting a little surreal and dreamlike, especially in the shape of the trees. And although objects are still recognizably what they are, they're starting to take on a slight tinge of nightmare. And then the final one, this one possibly is 1922, but it had to have been painted before 1923, which is when Colette Hemingway notes that all three paintings were in the Hemingway's collection. This one is full on surrealism. It's got just a suggestion of figures you can recognize. Yes, they're trees. Yes, there's a sun, but everything is weirdly serpentine. Some are stick figures, and it takes on elements of deeply personal symbolism. Hemingway didn't go there. I know that we're running late, but I do want to end with some Ernest Hemingway, specifically on these paintings of Masson. I don't like this one, so I'm gonna go back to that one because I like it better. In the green hills of Africa, Masson is mentioned glancingly in a conversation. "By God, isn't it good looking country?" I said. "Splendid," Pop said. "Who would have imagined it?" "The trees are like Andre's pictures," poor old Mama said. "It's simply beautiful. Look at that green. It's Masson." And the forest paintings are mentioned one more time in the posthumously published Islands in the Stream. Above the other bookcase was one of Masson's forests. He loved it the way he loved The Guitar Player, which is a painting by Juan Gris. That was the great thing about pictures. You could love them with no helplessness at all. You could love them without sorrow, and the good ones made you happy because they had done what you had always tried to do. So it was done and it was all right, even if you failed to do it. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you, everyone, so much. And thanks to our audience. I'm going to try to do speed round questions. So if you know the answer, jump in immediately. And the first one is, do we know how Hemingway and Hadley spent Christmas the first year in Paris? What did they do? Do we know?
In bed.
I can't believe I remember this from 35 years ago. Maybe I'm not remembering it correctly, but I think they went out to dinner, and when the bill came, they didn't have enough money to pay for it. And so Hemingway had to go back to the hotel and get the money, left Hadley at the table. And that was Christmas, the first Christmas in Paris.
Did he come back?
I think he came back.
Okay. Very good. The song is Mary Chapin Carpenter's Mrs. Hemingway. There's a question, Jerry, about the dominant political groups in Paris in post-World War I, and was Hemingway invested in the political life of Paris at that time in any way?
I would say he, at that time, was staying pretty apolitical. There was a great tension between the far left, the Communist Party, and the Socialists. And of course, those two parties didn't get along at all. They were clashing with each other, but they were both aligned against the center right. And that's the party that won the election in 1920 that brought in the Aristide Briand government. Millerand was the prime minister, and then he had to step down. There was a big change in government, actually about 3 weeks after they arrived in Paris. Aristide Briand resigned. I'm thinking it was Poincaré who became premier at that point. I wish I had my notes in front of me, but yeah. And I would reference that Paris 1922 sketch taking place at the Porte Maillot, where the young boy that looks like a football player has just killed two policemen. He was very interested in the undercurrent of violence in Paris that was so different from the glamorous expatriate world that he lived in.
Great. There's another question for you, Jerry, about the cover of your collection for In Our Time, your critical edition. Is that a Gerald Murphy piece?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And thank you, Linda Patterson, for giving me a lot of good information. Linda Miller, who gave me a lot of good information. It seemed absolutely inevitable because it does say time unmistakably, and it also says modernism. And Hemingway discovered that painting in 1925. So it seemed like the perfect cover for In Our Time, even though it's not trees. Hilary, I take your point too. I was torn between the natural and the experimental.
Next question's for Hilary. Hilary, do we have any evidence that Hemingway ever read Ulysses? Is there another version with all the pages cut open?
Hemingway did own another copy of Ulysses. We don't have it. Evidence that he read it, it would be so nice if he made little, you know, marginalia notes throughout everything he read. He didn't tend to do that. He tended to doodle in the margins rather than actually write words. So without seeing that other copy, though, I know that he owned it. I can't say for sure that he read it.
Part of the manuscript of the Garden of Eden is written on the back of a really obscure piece of criticism of Oxen and the Sun. So it's like, that was interesting.
We also have a question about Hemingway and Hadley's dance habits in Paris, since the Bal Musette was downstairs. Do we know if they liked to dance when they were in Paris?
Yes, again, if my memory is serving me correctly, they did go over there and dance, and Hadley would be tapped by some ruffian and she would dance. And then Hemingway, as Hadley said, would just grab anything he could get his hands on and dance. And don't forget, they were drinking. So, you know, this was probably a lot of carousing fueled by alcohol. But that's the only place I know of that they danced, was at the Bal Musette.
Okay, great. And I'm sorry for the speed round, but I am trying, but there are good questions here. There's a reference to the Tulsa massacre that took place in the middle of 1921. And there was a reference to many different groups living in Paris at the time. So was there an American expatriate reaction to the Tulsa massacre? Were they aware of it? Do we know if there was a response to it?
The question was breaking up.
Oh, I'm sorry. Can you hear me now? Oh, you're muted, Jerry. Can everybody hear me? Is that okay? Okay, so yeah, the Tulsa massacre happened in 1921. And so there is a question if there was a response by the American expatriate community or even an awareness about that massacre.
I vaguely recall. I mean, I remember that U.S. troops stayed in France long after the war and really whipped up a lot of resentment among the French for the things they did. I don't know if this is the historical context that you're alluding to, but there was a lot of lingering bad feeling, even though the Americans had entered the war and in effect helped to liberate France and defeat the Germans. But I may be just missing. I'm not 100% sure I'm recognizing the this massacre that you're referencing. So
I think one thing to remember about the expatriate community is it wasn't a unified bloc. It was large, it was diverse. I think some of the expatriate community would absolutely have been aware of it. Whether there was a statement made by any of the artists that we've spoken of, any of the people in Hemingway's circle, I've never seen anything. But it is absolutely certain that the expatriate African-American community in Paris would have known about it and they would have talked about it. I don't know of any statements that were issued though.
Now that we have access to, I mean, the Herald Tribune and the Paris Times and things like that, you know, through the digital archives of the Bibliothèque Nationale, it would be pretty easy to check and see what was actually published in, you know, the expatriate newspapers there.
Okay, two very quick final questions and then a note about the membership meeting, everyone. So first, is there shrapnel from Hemingway's injury at the JFK, we are being asked?
Yes, and in fact, as it is three-dimensional, it is held in the museum objects part of the collection. Hemingway kept shrapnel and a couple of bullets in his good luck charm purse, believe it or not. So there's a piece of shrapnel about this long that's believed to be from World War I in Italy, and dum-dum bullets about this big, a bullet set into a ring. And then one of the other good luck charms he always carried was a small compass set in a Petoskey stone. So he would always know that Michigan was home.
Great. OK, Okay. And Camila from Paris is asking, is there any reference to the North African soldiers, many Algerians, forcibly enrolled in World War I to fight in the French army in Hemingway's work?
I would say yes. He did he included in Paris 1922 the two Senegalese soldiers who are fascinated by the cobra at the Jardin des Plantes. And as I pointed out in, I think the talk I gave in Paris in 2019, I'm virtually certain that Hemingway knew the reputation of the Senegalese as having saved Paris in the Battle of the Marne. So, I think he could have picked any number of African colonial soldiers, but I think the choice of the Senegalese was probably very mindful on his part. He also reviewed a novel called Batuala that talks about the Black man's view of the white man. And it's one of the most unusual reviews in the early part of Hemingway's career and well worth taking a look at.
Okay, thank you. So I'm going to share my screen. This is your invitation. You will get it in the mail as well to our second annual Holidays with Hemingway on Friday, December 17th at 8 p.m. I would also like to let everybody know that a recording of this session will be made available on the Hemingway Society website probably early next week, because a number of you asked about the recording. And last but not least, for the membership meeting, I can't put a link to the meeting in the chat because you have to be registered to attend. It is one of the ways that we try to make sure that only members attend and that it's a safe meeting. We don't get Zoom bombed and things like that. You can register. If you're not a member, you can go to the Hemingway Society website at hemingwaysociety.org and join and register right away. And if you have registered, you should have received about an hour ago a reminder with your link to the meeting in your email inbox. So I just want to thank everybody who participated today for the incredible presentations. The audience, you guys had fantastic questions, and we didn't feel, I don't think, rushed, and we covered a lot of ground and we got to all of the questions. So thanks to everybody for a wonderful session, and I hope to see you in a few minutes in the meeting. All right, everyone, take care. See you. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye-bye.
Thanks.
Bye.
Thank you.